Everyone, speaking on behalf of Lakshmi Organic Industries Limited, I'm Lalit Jaising from Concept PR and your moderator for this virtual brokers and analysts webinar. I would take this opportunity to thank you for taking our time for your busy schedules to join us. We appreciate your presence and extend a very warm welcome to all of you. The objective of today's live session is to understand Lakshmi Organic's interest in raising finance via an initial public offering and what they do as a business organization. Under a normal circumstance, this would have been an on-ground event, but we are all increasingly getting accustomed to this as a safer and more convenient format of attending and conducting the roadshow. We hope you gather the same or a better experience from the comfort of your home and office. Before I review the functionality of the webinar, I would like to bring to light that the company has almost three decades of experience in large-scale manufacturing of chemicals. Its journey of transformation has made it amongst the largest manufacturers of ethyl acetate in the country. Till almost a decade back, it acquired Clariant's Decathine business and stands to have the largest portfolio and is the only manufacturer of Decathine derivatives in India. Moving ahead, you'll be kept on mute throughout the event and all questions will be answered via the Q&A chat box only, where you can type your question in session or at the end of the webinar. Would request all participants to please limit yourself to three questions if possible and use a lowercase font while typing the question. If we miss any of your questions, don't worry. You can email us at ipoteam@conceptpr.com and we will try to be swift in responding back to you. Moving ahead, it's a great pleasure to introduce our speakers of today. From the company, we have Mr. Ravi Goenka, Chairman and Managing Director, Mr. Satej Nabar, Executive Director and CEO, Mr. Partha Roy Chaudhary, Chief Financial Officer, and Mr. Harsh Goenka, Executive Director, Strategy and Business Development. The representation of the bankers are Mr. Akhil Kejriwal, Senior Vice President, Investment Banking, Axis Capital Limited, and Mr. Kamrat Singh Negi, Managing Director, DAM Capital. On behalf of the lead managers to the issue, let me thank all participants for being a part of this session and I now invite Mr. Kamrat Singh Negi from DAM Capital to deliver the opening remark and commence this press conference.
Thank you, Bharat. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of DAM Capital Advisors Limited, I welcome you all to the Virtual Brokers Conference, Lakshmi Organic Industries Limited, IPO. I hope you all are doing well and keeping safe. We at DAM Capital feel extremely privileged and honored to be associated with Lakshmi Organic Industries. Before we start, I know Lalit has done it, but I'll do it in much more detail. I would like to introduce the team that we have here today. Mr. Ravi Goenka, the Chairman and Managing Director of the company. He holds a bachelor's degree in chemical engineering from Bangalore University. He has been associated with the company since inception and has approximately 30 years of experience in the chemicals and papers industries. He's got 16 years of experience in the education industry and 21 years in the power industry. He was the ex-trustee of Mumbai Port Trust and Jawaharlal Nehru Port Trust and is presently the president of the executive committee of the Indian Chemical Council for the period from 2020 to 2022. Mr. Satej Nabar, he is the executive director and CEO of the company. He holds a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from the University of Bombay, a master's degree in plastic engineering from University of Bombay, and a chartered engineer registered with the Institution of Engineers. He has around 31 years of experience in the chemicals industry and has handled numerous functions, including sales and marketing, corporate strategy, innovation and manufacturing. Prior to joining the company, the key assignments he was associated with were Atul Limited, Reliance Industries, Bhur Industries, BSF Southeast Asia. We also have Mr. Harshvardhan Goenka. He is an executive director of business development and strategy of the company. He holds a bachelor's degree in science from Babson College, School of Business, Boston, USA. He has 9 years experience in the chemicals industry. He has been associated with the company since September 2011 and heads the business development initiatives of the company. Mr. Partha Rai Chaudhary is the chief financial officer of the company. He's also an associate member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and has more than 31 years of experience in building and leading businesses through complex operational issues, financial restructuring, internal expansion, capital markets transaction. We also have with us my fellow banker from Axis Capital, Akhil Kejriwal. I will not take much time explaining the company to you all, but given the journey that Lakshmi Organic Industries Limited team has gone through, it is worth mentioning. Lakshmi Organics is the leading manufacturer of acetyl intermediates and specialty intermediates with almost 3 decades of experience in large-scale manufacturing of chemicals. Company's products are currently divided into 2 broad categories, namely the acetyl intermediates and specialty intermediates. These products find applications in various high-growth industries, including pharmaceuticals, agrochemicals, dyes and pigments, inks and coatings, paints, flavors and fragrances, adhesives, and other industrial applications. The company proposes to diversify into manufacturing of high-margin specialty fluorochemicals, and the company has recently acquired assets of Mitni, a manufacturer of organic fluoro specialties and electrochemical fluorination. About the IPO, this IPO is a combination of fresh issuance of INR 300 crores and offer for sale of INR 300 crores. We have concluded pre-IPO issuance of INR 200 crores with marquee names. Price band is INR 129 to INR 130. Total issue size will be INR 600 odd crores. Issue opens to public on Monday, March 15, 2021 and closes on Wednesday, March 17. We have received strong interest from marquee domestic as well as foreign investors, which is testimony of how investors have acknowledged the journey of this company. I'll now hand it over to the moderator and thereafter the management team will take you through the business presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Negi, for the introduction to Lakshmi Organics' initial public offering and the issue's key highlights. Let's now get to hearing from the Technocat management and the leadership. I would now request Mr. Ravi Goenka, Mr. Satej Nabar, Mr. Partha Roy Chaudhary, and Mr. Harsh Goenka to take us through the organization's journey, struggles, victories, subsequently take the attendees through the company's investor presentation to cover its business and financial details, as well as touch upon the key strategies going forward. Over to you, Mr. Goenka.
Very good evening to everyone. Thank you very much, Lalit, for giving us this opportunity. And thank you to all the audience for taking out time and the patience to hear our own journey. We will be happy to take you through our last 30 years and a brief snapshot of the next 5 years as we see it. So let me get on with our own journey. Actually, a little before 1992, before Lakshmi was born, I'd like to go back to 1985 when I did my chemical engineering from Bangalore University and came back home to Bombay. And my father insisted that I should get into manufacture of chemicals and not get into the family business of distribution of paper. Off I went and chose a product, chose a technologist and a site. And fast forward 3 years, I had completely washed out my entire family money. Whatever could go wrong, did go wrong. And we were at a family net worth of negative values. But 2 lessons that I learned from this experience. 1 was technology is king. 2 was scalability is king. So with this learning in 1990, I got again an opportunity to set up a greenfield acetic acid plant with the help of loans and advances from friends and family and promoters' equity from financial institutions. We could set up a plant of manufacturing glacial acetic acid. And this time we chose the best technology available, that was Kematur of Sweden. And bang, in 12 months, we had our plant completely commissioned, giving us the required volumes, the required quality, and the required consistency, yields, etc. After that, we have not looked back. We have grown our business many times over, and we have scaled the business many times over, taking a dominant position. This is primarily the business that we call the acetyl intermediate business. It is a high volume and a value-added product on some basic petroleum downstream products. Moving on, in 2005-06, we identified ethyl acetate, which is a green solvent. And at that time in India, there was just a few scarce manufacturers in the small scale sector of manufacturing this product, doing a batch process. We were the first ones in India to set up a continuous plant of ethyl acetate. And we again chose the best technology, which is Kemator, again of Sweden, and implemented India's first plant. We had consistent quality of the highest purity. And this is what established us as the gold standard in ethyl acetate quality, established us as a dependable manufacturer and as a partner for long term. The customers that we had during those times, whether pharma, flexible packaging industry in the early 1990s, are still our customers after so many years, and we are always their first port of call in all their requirements. This business, both of these businesses, along with some ethanol that we produce for the OMCs, is what we call acetyl intermediates. We have grown this all the time, having outpaced the demand and kept a leadership position in India and kept a leadership position on the export side of these products from India. In 2009, we got an opportunity to again look at the acquisition of the entire chemistry platform of Clariant, a Swiss company for manufacturing diketene derivatives. This was again a value-added product. Primarily, Clariant used to use it for the pigment industry. And this was situated on the suburbs of Bombay in Thane. And therefore, Clariant was very having nightmares thinking of running such a hazardous chemistry in a residential suburb and wanted to exit that business. Also, it was not their core business. And of course, the land that it was situated on, they valued it much more than the value of the business itself. So amongst a lot of other bidders, we could successfully bid for this asset. And then we had the onerous task of actually shifting this asset from its location at Thane to a new greenfield site at Mahad. And from the day we started dismantling this project at Thane to the day we commissioned safely our project in Mahad, it was all of 90 days. You can imagine the kind of work that has gone in and the kind of intense effort that would have gone in to do such a very clean and reconstruction of an entire plant. But in 2010-11, we commissioned this plant. All our customers, we could supply them seamlessly for their requirements. And today we are the only manufacturers of this chemistry. Having scaled it up, we are also dominant players in India. In 2012, when we were ready to scale this business up, not only in terms of value, but in terms of volume as well, and in terms of the number of products that we wanted to offer, we got IFC as an investor with us, and they gave us growth capital. And they invested in us as partly debt and also invested in the equity of our company. In 2019, IFC exited as per the terms of the agreement with them. They are a happy investor, and we share the best of relationships with them. And we had a lot to learn from them in terms of structure, professionalizing, and a lot of many other things. Along the way, in 2018, we also commissioned a hydroelectric power plant in our need for going more green in the business. And we probably are one of the few chemical companies who have their own captive hydropower plant in Maharashtra. Since 2017, we have been discussing our own customers in the pharma and agro segment have been reaching out to us and telling us to get into fluorochemicals, since many of their new molecules contain 1, 2, or 3 fluorine molecules. With this in mind, we approached ICIG, which was the erstwhile owner of Miteni, to have a joint venture with us in India. And we had advanced discussions for this joint venture. We had discussed a business plan and were at the verge of signing the agreement, which is when ICIG had to let go of Miteni, their fluorochemical business itself, due to an exigency and at their end. This gave us an opportunity to acquire the entire Miteni plant in Italy, which is a top-class European asset, having the best technology, along with their patents, along with their REACH registrations, along with all their plant and machinery. And we acquired this business and are today doing the same thing which we did back in 2010-11 of shifting it from location A to our new greenfield site at Lote. Right from the beginning, I just want to tell you a little bit. Right from the beginning, we have been very fortunate to have the best of people as independent directors in our company. We had Mr. R.M. Mandari, who was at that time the chairman of Hindustan Petroleum. And we also had Mr. Bafna, who was a member of the company law board. And with such stalwarts guiding our culture, we have always had the culture of running a public listed company, although we have always been a deemed public limited company. I think we are at an inflection point in our life cycle. And I will now ask Satej to delve deeper into the two segments that we work on. Harsh will talk about the specialty intermediate and R&D, and Partha will then take you through a little bit of our fluoro business and also our financial models. Over to you, Satej.
Thanks, Raviji, and good evening, everyone. So Lakshmi today is a 1,500 crore company with 650 employees, six manufacturing sites, sales offices in India, and sales subsidiaries across the globe, in Shanghai, in Sharjah, in Netherlands, and we are very close to opening up an office in the US. We manage our business in three verticals, the acetals intermediate vertical, AI, the specialty intermediate vertical, SI. These two verticals are operational and they have differentiated business models. And we are also working on the third vertical, which is the fluorine specialties, which will be based on the technology platform that we acquired from Miteni last year. In terms of our capacities, we have close to 240,000 tons of manufacturing capacities. And as a company, we are moving more than 500,000 tons of products every year globally. In terms of our business mix, almost 60% of our revenues come in through the AI vertical. And the EBITDA is the portion of AI is 40% in the EBITDA. Moving forward, a little bit more about our AI vertical. So this has been our backbone of all our growth initiatives. And the vertical is about sales of ethanol and its derivatives, value-added products of ethanol, like ethyl acetate, which is called ETAC in short, acetaldehyde, and other value-added customized solvents. And ethyl acetate is by far the largest product in this portfolio. So if you were to imagine any Lay's packet or a Maggie packet or a shampoo sachet or any flexible packaging or a laminate for that matter, now these products cannot be printed without our product. And ETAC is a green solvent. So it is kind of fast replacing other harmful solvents, especially for food packaging. So we look at this product as a sort of an upstream of FMCG. And additionally, we also sell this product in the agro and the pharma industry. So every API manufacturer in the country is our customer. And so it's the case with the agro intermediate producer. In developed countries, almost 70% of ethyl acetate that is produced globally finds applications in packaging, whereas in India, it's largely dominated by agro and pharma. So you would imagine that as our disposable incomes will increase and our lifestyles change, this is going to create a huge exponential potential for this product. We have established, this vertical is through our all the initiatives that we have taken through these over the period of all these years, and the differentiated model that we have built in our supply chain. This vertical today is a cash cow for us. So it's high in ROC and low in working capital. So to give you some numbers, on a top line of about 800 to 1,000 crores, we employ a working capital of just about 50 crores in this vertical. We also have a significant market share in the domestic industry, and almost 30% of our produce, of our volumes are exported for this product. Moving to the SI vertical, so this is the vertical that we have built over the chemistry platform that we acquired from Clariant. And while ethyl acetate is a derivative of acetic acid, ketene, diketene derivatives, which are forming a part of this particular vertical, are also derivatives of acetic acid, and that's where we have the raw material synergies. To give you some applications of this vertical, so if you were to imagine a paracetamol, any Crocin, aspirin, or any drug that ends with dipin, these products cannot be produced without our product. Also, any yellow color that you see, especially in the textiles or in the automotive industry, cannot be made without our products. We have a basket of almost about 34 different products in this portfolio. And we are the only manufacturers in the country for ketene and diketene derivatives. We also believe that we have the largest portfolio of diketene derivatives globally. So our growth driver here is import substitution. And we have a market share of about 55%, and the balance is all imported. So that's where we have the headroom to grow. And every year, a significant portion of our revenues in this vertical are coming in from new products and new applications that we have developed. So some of the applications that we developed in the recent past find applications for making acrylic emulsions that go for decorative paints, and all the global producers of acrylic emulsions like Dow, BASF, Sherwin-Williams are now in discussions with us for long-term supplies. The other product that we have recently developed also has applications for making unsaturated polyester resin that goes for making of windmill blades. Moving forward, a little bit about our organization structure and our board. Harsh, can you move to the next slide?
It's changed at my end. So I'm on the board of directors slide.
Okay, so yeah, so these are our independent directors, and we have Dr. Rajiv Vaidya on the board. Dr. Vaidya comes in with several years of experience with DuPont, and he has spent considerable amount of his time in the fluorospecialty business. So he brings in a lot of experience in that field, and he's going to be one of our guiding force as we get into this vertical. As our chairman mentioned earlier, we have Mr. Manish Chokhani and Mr. Bundelu, who continue to be on our board. Mr. Chokhani and Mr. Bundelu have long experience in the finance and investment banking sector. And we have Ms. Sangeeta Singh, who has spent long years with KPMG India as their director for HR services. And this is our leadership team. So along with the board and the leadership team, this team also supports the operational and the strategic guidance to the company. So we have colleagues who have come in from well-governed Indian companies as well as multinationals like Asian Paints, Huhtamaki, Naveen Fluorine, Kellogg's, Hindustan Lever, BASF, SRF, and so on. So we bring in a lot of best practices from our previous companies. And along with the inherent strengths of Lakshmi, we are now ready to take this company into the next orbit. Let me now talk to you about our differentiating factors. And these are our sustainable competitive advantages. And the first one is about the fact that we are leading manufacturers of ETAC. And this is something that I've kind of covered extensively in my previous slide. So let me move to the next differentiator, which is about the fact that we are we have a diversified customer base across high growth industries, and we are selling into various industries that are growing. Fortunately for us, at double digits, they are also expected to grow at double digits in the next 4 or 5 years. And besides these, we will be also moving into other industries like aerospace, like electronics, like automotive, as we get into the fluorine vertical. So with several products in our portfolio, many customers across diversified industries, we are continuously optimizing our customer and product mix to maximize our margins. This slide, this differentiator is about our marquee customers. Most of these customers have been on a fold for more than 25, 30 years. So for example, Mylan, which was earlier known as Matrix, or Uber, which was earlier known as Hindustan Inc., have been on our product list for a very long time. So some of these customers started buying our products in the AI vertical. And as we moved into the SI vertical, as we developed products on the SI platform, we started working closely with these customers to develop products on that platform. And we have also identified several projects with some of these customers as we get into the fluorine vertical. So it's not just about selling products, but it's about creating value for them. And we are building relationships for a sustainable future. We continuously strive to be a supplier of choice to each and every customer of ours. The next differentiator is about our global presence. This is not just about geographical hedging, but also about forex hedging. We are currently present in more than 30 countries. As I was telling you earlier, currently the AI vertical is dominating this export business, but SI is fast catching up. As we start developing more and more products, we will start exporting the SI products into the global markets. I mentioned to you about our subsidiaries. These subsidiaries across the globe are manned. We have feet on the ground, and that helps us in terms of improving our market intelligence, and we are able to proactively respond to the customer and market needs. The next differentiator is about our supply chain efficiencies. And our site where we manufacture ethyl acetate produces close to 200,000 tons of manufacturing products. We consider that this mega site is among the top three mega sites in the world outside of China. The other site where we make the SI products is at a distance of about 2 kilometers from this mega site, and they are connected through pipelines for easy transportation of material and energy cables. These two sites are also in close proximities to several all-weather ports. So there are many ports at a radius of about 200 kilometers from the site. We are also strategically placed closer to our customers. The pharmaceutical industry is majorly centered around the southern part of India, whereas the agro intermediate manufacturers are both in the southern and the western part. So we have a clear locational advantage, both in terms of our incoming as well as our manufactured products. In terms of our raw materials, so while I mentioned to you about acetic acid, which is the raw material synergies that we have. We are the largest consumers of acetic acid in the country and the largest importer of acetic acid. The other major raw material is ethanol, and we are backwardly integrated into ethanol. So we have two distilleries that produce ethanol for us. And we are also incidentally the largest importers of ethanol in the country. On the SI front, we manufacture our own diketene. So we have a clear control on our raw materials. In terms of our energy requirements, almost 50% of the power that we require is generated in-house. And we generate power through renewable resources like the windmills. And incidentally, we may be the only chemical company in the country which is generating power through hydroelectric turbines. We also have cogen set. Now, AI products need a lot of low pressure steam, whereas the SI products need power. So we have cogen set that regularly supply power and steam to each of these respective units. In terms of our tankages, we have tankages at the port, and these are kind of fungible tankages. We are able to leverage between the incoming raw materials and the finished goods moving out of the country. We also have storage locations at various points across Europe, and these help us to supply consistent and quality products to our customers in Europe. So we are closer to the customers and we deliver products to them at short notice. So with that, I'll hand over the presentation to Harsh.
Thanks, Satej, and good evening, everyone. Let me tell you a little bit more about our SI business. So we acquired this business from Clariant, as my colleagues mentioned earlier. And Clariant used to utilize this platform primarily to serve the pigment and pigment intermediates product portfolio for itself or its self-consumption. Lakshmi came in, added on 5 new chemistry platforms, which allowed us to expand the product portfolio as well as serve pharma and agro segments better. So through this, we've now developed the largest portfolio in this value chain. And anything coming up in this value chain, we would be a supplier of choice. The domestic market share, we've been able to take up significantly. And now we have about 55% market share in this business unit. We could not have done this without our R&D. So we have about 50 scientists working at 2 R&D centers, one in Mumbai and one at our site. At any given point, you would have 15 to 20 products in the concept to commercialization pipeline and at various stages of development. Talking about our success in R&D, I think we've got about 50%, 45% from new products since we acquired Clariant. That speaks about our ability to develop products from a lab level to an actual large dedicated multi-purpose plant. Some company strategies, I think a lot of you would be reading about some tailwinds going on in the chemical industry, and I'd like to highlight that again. So the China plus one approach, where we have a lot of customers wanting to hedge out their supply chains and are looking to India to build as an alternate. And the second is a lot of pharma agro customers are requiring new molecules, and Lakshmi's existing and new upcoming platforms make us perfectly poised to service these requirements. How do we serve this? I think both business units have their independent strategy. So AI is all about volume maximization. Given that we have a mega site, we can add on incremental capacity at the lowest possible cost, thereby not only expanding the margin, but also ensuring leadership. SI is all about margin expansion by value adding on the existing portfolio and getting into long-term contracts. Two such contracts have been signed off and are under execution today. Historically, we've been primarily focused on the domestic market, especially in the SI segment. However, we have been seeding international markets such as US, China, and Japan, and are now going to focus on these markets going ahead. Innovation is something where we have had success in the past, but recognize the need to further invest in innovation and grow this further, especially with our new upcoming fluorine technologies. Fluorination, again, is something that we've heard of from the voice of our customers for more than 3 or 4 years. where they've been requesting us for fluorination molecules. And rather than develop the wheel from scratch, we thought of taking on a scalable platform. And that's how we've really gone ahead and got Miceni. So I'll request my colleague Partha to tell you a little bit more about the fluorine opportunity.
So thanks, Harsh, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. So fluorine is a chemistry play. It's a niche technology area completely dominated by a handful of players like 3M, Asahi Glass, Solvay, K-Mors, etc. outside of China. We have gotten an excellent opportunity by way of acquisition of these Miceni assets and everything else which had come with that. And we believe our success factors are the following. See, for example, the state-of-the-art European assets that we've gotten and the technology alongside that, and a library of more than 100 products which have been at some stage produced in those equipment. We have more than 20 years of paperwork, which includes process parameters, maintenance logs, research paperwork, patent, more than 40 REACH registrations, etc. We have the Miceni teams, and I mean teams working with us, which includes their erstwhile managing director, the heads of their manufacturing, heads of quality assurance and R&D, along with some of their team members. We also have the managing director of Miceni working with us. In addition to all these things, we have an in-house team which had done this relocation exercise once before in 2010-11 in record time. That's what gives us the confidence that we shall be able to succeed and succeed very well in this project. In terms of our differentiation from the other fluorinated players in India and also overseas, we are starting upstream with chlorotoluenes. So we are starting with chlorine and toluene as our raw materials. Then we are doing various chlorination steps, conventional chlorinations like ring chlorination, etc. We are doing photochlorination. And then we are introducing hydrofluoric acid, anhydrous hydrofluoric acid, to do the fluorination and produce the derivatives or fluorinated derivatives. The photochlorination technology, which we believe we have got, is very differentiated in terms of its scale and perfection. And we believe this is what we are introducing into India. In addition to this, we have also got an electrochemical fluorination technology from Miceni, which is practiced by a very few companies in the world. And this is also being introduced into India for the first time. And the products out of this chemistry are going to be functional chemicals. In terms of the market size, the addressable market is approximately $10 billion US dollars, which includes sizable imports into India as well. Out of which, specialty organic fluorides catering to the pharma and agro is of the order of 6 to 7 billion. Then we have the fluorocarbons, which is approximately 3 to 4 billion. However, we are starting to with products which will cater to the automotive industry. As fire retardants in polycarbonates, it will cater to aviation fluids and the electronic industry. These products have been selected based on our customer overtures, as more than 70% of the customers in our fluorochemicals initiative are already our customers in the specialty intermediates and in the acetyls intermediate space. So just to give you a heads up on this, we are starting with about 15 to 20 established products of Miceni, which they have been producing until the last 3-4 years when they closed down at the end of 2018. Our technology absorption is on the way. The R&D work is going on. We are also in the process of setting up a kilo level lab, which should be up and running very quickly. We expect to commission this plant towards the end of financial year 22, which will begin a few days from now. Coming to the financials of the company, before I get into the financial numbers, I would like to talk about a few financial principles which we use in taking all the decisions in Lakshmi Organic. And they have held us in excellent state over last several years. These principles are cash flows. We are highly focused on cash flows, and every decision that we take, we evaluate the cash flow implications. We are focused on working capital. We do modular capexes, and we always try and maintain a low gearing, hence a light balance sheet. What has it all done for Lakshmi? Over the last 1 decade, ending FY20, our revenues have grown by 7 times, EBITDA by 10 times, and net worth by 12 times. Taking into consideration the last 5 years, again, ending FY20, our AI and SI revenues have grown by 1.5 times, contribution nearly doubled, and all this while, specialty intermediates, which is a relatively new business for us, could maintain a contribution margin of about 32 to 35%. Between FY18 and FY20, AI revenues grew by 30% on the back of similar volumes. Contribution grew by 14%. And I would like you to take note of the fact that this is something which has happened through in the middle of an extremely low cycle in this segment. SI revenues and contributions were steady during this period, despite losing 45 operating days in FY20 because of 2 major events. One is a very unfortunate event of having a flood in the second quarter of the year, for which we had to shut down our manufacturing site for more than 30 days. And then again in the fourth quarter, we had the COVID-related disruptions. So more than 15% of the productive number of days were actually lost in FY20. FY21, we are more than back on track. We had a good H1, which is in the document. And we expect to return very healthy performance during the rest of the year. So the working capital trajectory, asset turns, etc., would be similar to what you have seen here, and the debt equity and the gearing would further go down. We would be able to maintain and better the other financial parameters like ROE, ROC, etc. Thank you, sir. I leave the platform back to you now.
Thank you, Partha. I think there are a lot of questions already. Before I take some closing remarks, I would like to give it back to Lalit for taking up any questions, and our team over here will be happy to answer your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Goenka, Mr. Nabar, Mr. Chaudhary, Harsh, for taking us through the presentation. The specialty chemical sector is definitely poised to drive growth in various sectors, particularly agrochemicals and pharma chemicals. While India accounts for only 3.5% of the market share in the global chemicals market, APAC is anticipated and forecasted to grow between 7 to 8% up to FY24. We hope the attendees have captured enough and more understanding of Lakshmi Organic's business model, its financial soundness and differentiated product portfolio. Before the floor is open to participants to ask their questions, I would like to reiterate to type your name and organization details in the Q&A chat box for the moderator to take note and address your query. Note, in the interest of time, we will be restricting to 20-25 questions only. Repetitive questions will be skipped. To begin with, can we ask this question that, how much time does it take for the company, to go from concept to commercialization?
I'll take that, Lalit. Products that the quickest that we've done historically is 9 months, but that would be an aberration. Most products would take anywhere from 12 to 15 months to reach a full-scale plant.
Okay, but given that we're a large player, you know, in the ethyl acetate space, you know, how big is this segment, and you know, what is the moat around you know, the company particular to this segment, besides the other players, if you could you know, identify them too.
Yeah, so you know, so ethyl acetate, I think the biggest moat I would call is our supply chain efficiencies. We are differentiated in terms of our mega site. Our mega site not only allows us, we are just like three or four in the world that have this capacity at one location. And the physical proximity, not only to the port, but even customers, gives us logistical advantages. We have international storage and feet on the ground. That's another advantage. And of course, we have the AI and SI linkage, where you've got the same raw materials going into both businesses. So you get economies of scale over there. Plus you have a CPP or a captive power plant, which feeds steam to the AI business and power to the SI business, making both very, very competitive.
Okay, so as you talked about the captive power plant, you've got a 47% dependence, you know, on power when it comes to the grid. And rest is, of course, from your cogeneration plants that you have from two windmills and a hydroelectric power project. Do you intend to reduce the grid dependence in the future?
Go ahead, Partho.
Yeah. See, this is our initiatives in the power sector is an initiative which we have taken on our own. Of course, we would like to create a situation where the grid dependence goes down, but it will have to have an economic reason behind that as well. So as we are speaking, we are also sort of trying to get more and more into renewables. So that is going to remain our focus going forward.
Okay, sir. So there's no captive power coming from a coal-based plant, right?
We can't confirm that to you, Lalit, right away. We will see how the economics pan out going forward. Yeah.
Okay, so with given the, you know, trade unrest, you know, in China and the focus on Atma Nirbharta, what are your dependencies from China with respect to raw materials and revenues?
Harsh, you can take that, please.
So raw material front, I think very early on we've identified a simple need to have multiple suppliers across regions. And we are lucky that now, after our strategy has worked out and customers are giving us the benefit, as less than 25% of our raw materials come from China. And in fact, China is now one of our strategic markets for products where we have achieved technological and scale, technological excellence and scale.
Okay, there's a statement which asks that, as you've said that, you know, there is a raw material synergy between AI and SI. How much do we consume as ETAC captively?
An insignificant amount of ETAC is consumed captively. Acetic acid and ethanol are the raw materials that feed both value chains.
There's a question which asks that, why has the profit before tax fallen from 113 crores in FY 2018 to 55 crores in FY 2020?
Yeah. So as I had explained earlier, there are two reasons. One is this is a period during which we have been into an extremely low cycle in our acetyl segment, which has hit the margins. And also, we had more than 15% of our productive days not available in FY20. So these are the two reasons why there has been a shortfall in the profits versus earlier periods. However, but I would like to add one rider here. I don't think Lakshmi is a company which one can look at on a quarter to quarter or even year to year basis. You will have to look at slightly longer term trajectories. And just to give you a sense of these longer term trajectories, I would like to highlight here that in the 10 years ending FY20, as I said, the revenues have grown by 20%, CAGR, EBITDA by about 21%, and the net worth or the PAT has grown by about 23 to 25%. If I take 5 years, the same numbers have respectively grown by about 12%, which is a top line, 18% EBITDA, and the net worth has grown also by about 18 to 19%. So this is the trajectory which we have been able to achieve in the past, and we believe we'll be able to achieve this, achieve similar trajectories going forward.
Okay, so there's a question which asks that what is the contribution from the new products in SI in the last 2 years? What is the ROC and working capital requirements from the special intermediates business?
So, Harsh, I'll take this question. So, just to give you a sense of the new products, in FY13, we were less than 100 crores in the SI business, products which we got in from Clariant, etc. And today we are about, we should be about 500 odd crores, okay, in that. So, that is the growth which has come from the new products, number one. In terms of the ROE, ROC, obviously the SI business is not as ROCE accretive as our AI business, but it has market comparable sort of numbers. And as I said, the contribution margin has always been over the last 7-8 years between 32 to 35%. And on an overall basis, if you look at our company's numbers, our cash fixed costs are about 7 to 8%, maybe 9% of the top line. So you can get a sense of the margins. Yeah.
Could you throw some light on the EBITDA margins for the AI, SI and export business?
See, I will not be able to give you specific numbers because going forward and even today, we consider this as one segment, one chemical segment. Then that is how we are going to report the numbers. But just to give you some headline sense, our acetyls business is a high single digit EBITDA and a very, very strong ROCE margin business. Whereas the SI business has market comparable, very strong EBITDA margin and somewhat lower ROC. The FI is going to be, our attempt is to see to it that our fluoro business generates or returns better than SI business financial parameters.
So the next question is on your supply demand dynamics. You know, how is it for the acetyl intermediates and specialty intermediates? Have prices fluctuated frequently, like in the case of other commodities? If yes, you know, could you identify the triggers that have done this?
I think, Harsh, you can take this.
Sure. So, as mentioned before, Lalit, the acetyl business has been through 30 years where you have experienced cyclicality, but has continued to throw out cash and be profitable irrespective of business cycle. So indeed, just like many other chemicals, the prices do go up as well. And we have seen that on the AI side, that view is not so much seen on the SI side, as those are a lot more specialized and focused molecules and have a narrower set of application areas. And the linkage between RMs to FG is not so much.
From the addressable market opportunity point of view in your existing products, who would you term as your competitors in the listed and unlisted space?
Sure. So first of all, as a company, we don't see anyone that is like for like, and you'll find this in many chemical companies. And we believe Lakshmi is unique in its own model with AI and SI having linkages, but still quite different in the way they we approach the business. Individually, on the AI side, you would have a Jubilant Life Science and INEOS internationally, a BP, who would be our competitors. On the SI side, there would not be any local competitors. However, internationally, there are some Swiss companies and some players from China that we compete with.
Okay, from a IPO funds point of view, there's a question which is asked that majority of your IPO funds is going to be deployed through a subsidiary. Can you throw a reason for that?
Yeah, I mean, it is not the majority of the IPO funds. Let me clarify. The primary issue, including the pre-IPO, is of the order of 500 crores. Out of that, nearly 180 crores will go in repayment or prepayment of the all the term debts, most of the term debts which we have on the balance sheet today. The other deployment is going to be on the capexes which are going on in the specialty intermediates business, which is in the entity or within Lakshmi Organic. And the balance will go into supporting the capex, which is in Yellowstone Fine, which is a 100% subsidiary of Lakshmi. We have this project housed in an independent company just to get the advantage of lower tax, income tax, because this is a company and a project which came up after October 2019. And that's a 100% owned subsidiary of Lakshmi. Yeah.
Okay. There's a question in saying that, can you please share comparable numbers for H1 FY20 revenue, EBITDA and PAT?
We can, but they are not readily available. We can always share this at a later stage.
Okay, sir. There's a question which asks that, you know, from the fluoro specialty business particularly, what is the kind of top line you expect to be added from this? You know, is Navin Fluorine a competitor to you?
The second question first, no. And the first question, the answer would be slightly forward looking. So I would not like to give any number on that. But it will have, asset turns of maybe 1.2 to 1.4 of that order. Depending on the size of the capex. Our capex size is of the order of about 230 to 250 crores. So, yeah.
This is a question which asks that what would be the balance useful life of the Miteni plant? Is this before refurbishment or after?
Again, second question to be answered first. It is, there will be refurbishment which will be done and upgradations which will be done. And in terms of the life of the asset, we don't think that a chemical plant has a finite life. If we do the maintenance properly, if we run those assets well, then from time to time, of course, there will be replacements. But as such, the plant should have a life which will go into very, very long periods of time.
There's a question which additionally asks that, to what extent are you backward integrated for ethanol and acetic acid, and how much percentage do you source externally?
Harsh?
Yeah, so in ethanol, about 20% of our ethanol we have captive usage of, but majority of ethanol and acetic acid is sourced from other producers.
Okay, sir. Just 1 minute. Let me just receive the other questions and respond back to you. There's a question which asks that, how do you see the existing capacities ramping up? Is there any timelines to this? What would be the utilization levels of YCPL, acetaldehyde, and ethyl acetate capacity? And how do you see it ramping up? Third question to that is, how do you see the working capital cycle panning out in the future?
So Lalit, I'll take the last question and then I will let Harsh to respond to the others. Okay. So the working capital cycle for the organization as a whole will remain on similar trajectory. However, if I have to see the assumptions which have undergone, which we have assumed for working out the numbers for the DRHP and RHP, it's broadly about 60 days net of turnover. Now I leave it to Harsh, please.
On the capacity utilization side, historically we have shared our acetyl intermediate capacity utilization, then we've been continuously taking that up. We see no reason why the similar trajectory could not be held. YCPL as well, we are able to take that up and add on capacity like we have in previous years. On the SI front, it's not about capacity utilization. We do not view the volume as the primary metric over there. It's more about product mix and our ability to change the product mix and go into value-added products is the strategy and focus of ours.
From the raw material point of view, considering that acetic acid and methanol are flammable and corrosive in nature, what are the safety measures that the company has put down to handle such kind of products? And have there been any kind of industrial, accident that has happened over the last 5 years?
So, simple answer, no, there's not been any incident. Acetic acid, methanol, ethanol, of course, they are flammable. The product diketene itself is extremely hazardous. And when they mix, they are at very different temperature profiles. So safety is, we are extremely cognizant of that. Two achievements, I would say to get IFC on board, we had to pass and undergo their thresholds and their testing limits. We had a team from Washington come down to validate what we said. So that speaks testimony of our safety standards. And of course, we are also a responsible care company, which there are hardly 50 companies in India and which are qualified with this.
Does this also spill over to, the certificate that you have from responsible care? Is that due diligence process? Looking at the safety aspect, of the plants?
Of course. So responsible care talks about what you do, not just by regulation, but also as a responsibility. That's the primary ethos, and which is what we try to live by.
Okay, there's a question which asks that, focusing on the specialty side, can we say that the SI vertical and fluorochemical business, which you will be commissioning and subsequently ramping up, be a much higher contributor in terms of achieving value-added margins, while volume growth, which is operating leverage, can be seen across the AI vertical?
Again, our DRHP talks about where we'll be utilizing the funds in which of our businesses. So again, I would not be able to make a futuristic statement, but I would request the analyst to take cue from that.
Okay, thank you, sir. We'll just get back to you with a few more questions. You've had very low revenue growth, which is 1396 crore in FY18 and 1628 crore in FY21. The revenue CAGR of 5.26%, profit CAGR of 6.2%. What is the reason for such low growth?
See, we have already, I think, touched upon this point earlier. One of the reasons is in the acetyl space, we were into a very low cycle after the third quarter of 2018-19. So that is one of the reasons why the acetyls revenues came down. And again, in FY20, the plant shutdown was there for more than 45 days. So we didn't have products to sell. So we had a volume shortfall. This is the reason why both the top lines and the profit lines, the results lines, did not show growth. But as I told you earlier, once you are able to have a look at the FY21 number, you would realize we are back on similar trajectory.
So there was a question which, you know, asks, you know, to the statements that, you know, we have, you know, signed long-term contracts. Are these multi-year contracts?
Yes, indeed. There are multi-year contracts that go on for a period of 5 years. And they have, though the, again, linkage of raw materials is not as high, they do have clauses that allow us to pass on any significant rise in raw materials.
Okay, so there's a question which asks that how difficult or easy would it be to attract the same customers of Miteni, as you know, they must have already started sourcing from other suppliers?
Again, wish we could answer that, but I think it might be futuristic. But I can state some past data, which is these are the customers who have requested us to get into fluorination and fluorination-based products. Therefore, us getting on a scalable platform gives them more confidence, we would believe, than our ability without Miteni.
Okay. Question to Mr. Goenka. Sir, how do you see the industry moving when it comes to the adoption of green solvents?
Thanks, Lalit. You know, green solvents in Europe, if you see, 70% of the solvents market or the ethyl acetate market is used by the flexible packaging industry. Whereas in India, it is sub 50 or sub 40%. My belief is that with the aromatic solvents being phased out and government has taken some definite steps towards that, there will be additional demand that will come in for green solvents like ethyl acetate. So other than the segment growth itself, which is a double-digit growth, my expectation is that demand for green solvents like ethyl acetate will go up much more than its own natural growth cycle.
Okay, so there's a question, rather a statement, which says that, you know, in spite of the great story, the strong industry tailwinds and market growth, your company has not been able to grow from the revenue and operating profit point of view in the last, you know, few years. Any reason for the lack of growth?
I think, Lalit, this has been explained twice over by Partha, and I think that should answer it. And also the rider is that the first half that has been already is with the investing investing community has shown a very strong track. And it is, we are back on track and more. And my belief is that going ahead also, without any other foreseen issues, the company should be on a strong track.
Thank you, sir. Lastly, how would you value the company?
It's invaluable.
Thank you, sir. We'll leave the balance questions, you know, to be reached out to the individual, you know, analysts in Britain. Thank you everyone for
just want to say a few words, Lalit. Please. I just want to say that it has been a pleasure to showcase our journey in Lakshmi to all of you, all the analysts and this community who actually tells the people about the genuineness of a company. It's a pleasure to have you all on board. I hope we have given you enough insights into our company. Do reach out separately if we can answer any of your unanswered queries. And for us, it has been a journey that has actually been very rewarding in terms of when we started off, our turnover was just 10 crores. We are today at more than 1500 crores, from managing 5,000 metric tons of product to managing more than 500,000 metric tons of product, and from a very small single-digit EBITDA to more than 150 whatever number of EBITDA crores today, I think we have come a long way. This could have been only possible due to the blessings of our parents, due to the alignment of the destinies of all the Lakshmiites with the destiny of Lakshmi itself. And I'm truly consider myself blessed that we have a team that will reach the aspirations. The whole chemical industry today is at an inflection point. The opportunity on the table, not only for Lakshmi, but the entire industry, have never been so robust before. And companies who have the bandwidth and the talent will really scale this and grow out of their own shells into much more valuable companies. So thank you again, gentlemen, for your time, for your genuine patience, and do look forward to interacting with you as we take on this new mantle of a public life.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Akhil Kejriwal, who is to make the closing speech, over to you before we end today's webinar.
Thanks, Lalit. Thanks, everyone. Thank you to the management for actually answering over 50 questions patiently. And I'm sure we are all enlightened and equally enthused, you know, by the Lakshmi Organic Industry story. It's an absolute pleasure to be a part of the IPO and to back first generation entrepreneurs. The management has met up with multiple investors across the globe. And one thing we can share with you is that the kind of response that we have received from marquee global investors just reemphasizes our confidence that an offering like this will always be welcomed by investors, irrespective of market conditions. And I would once again like to reiterate the key deal specs for you all. The issue opens on Monday, 15th March, and closes on Wednesday, 17th March. The price band for the IPO is Rs. 129 to Rs. 130 per share. Looking forward to your wholehearted support for the IPO. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kejriwal. Esteemed audience, we have now come to the end of the webinar. We look forward to your participation and support on making this initial public offering a great success. Wishing you all a great day and keep safe.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.